Topic is about the problem of irregular migration, and the motivation obviously is related to the human cost of irregular migration. The picture is from boats that were crossing the Mediterranean and where many people died trying to cross. So can we improve on that? This is the question we would like to address, in particular using an economic tool, which is a temporary visa. So there are more than 2.5 million people. Well, of course, illegal markets are very hard to calibrate and estimate, but this is the estimation. That are smuggled each year. So this feeds criminality because, of course, this money is not collected by government, but by mafia that abuse migrants. Also, we have a problem in advanced economy, especially in Europe, but also in the US, about illegal migration, which is really polarizing voters and is really strongly disapproved by them. So it's less clear about legal migration, but for instance, in France right now, we are moving towards a presidential election and immigration is a huge topic. And one part of it is the issue of illegal migration. On the other hand, in advanced economy, and this is especially true now that we have a boom in Europe and elsewhere, but especially in Europe. So we have market needs, labor market needs that are not met by resident workers. And this is true in countries like France, for instance, where social protection is quite generous. And because of that, you can be a bit picky about jobs. And some jobs are very, very hard to fill. So the question is very simple. There is a demand for low-skill workers. Low-skill workers are willing to come, and they, in fact, do that at a huge risk, personal risk. Can't we improve on this situation by completing market and offering a short-term visa? It turned out that for the first time in the Sustainable Development Goal, of 2030, one of them is to facilitate orderly, safe, regular, and responsible migration. I think it was time to introduce that. But this question will be even more acute with global warming and the disappearance of some countries. So this is an important issue. The literature on this topic, the first aspect is that there are missing migration market, and some people have suggested, economists in particular, to try to regulate this incomplete market with economic tools, so in particular auction, auction of visa. That was a proposal of Baker, and there has been a lot of discussion about this proposal. We, with Alice Ménard, we explore the issue of selling permanent visa, not temporary one, at an eviction price, which is a price designed to eradicate smuggler activities. But all these mechanisms, in fact, target wealthy migrants because the price of permanent visa or the price that you will catch in auction typically will be high, and that's totally is beyond the reach of poor workers in developing countries. So typically there is a policy trade-off between the migration flow that should increase following the sales of visa, and then this high price that attract only high-skilled migrants. And so typically there is a lack of channel for low-skilled poor migrants. That's why they use other means that are very dangerous for most of them. So in this paper, what we propose is to explore the possibility to use a temporary visa, so visa of duration TO, sell at price PL. First goal is to throttle smuggler activity. So we want to destroy any incentive to smuggler migrants illegally. This mechanism will be designed to attract low-skill workers on purpose. Which is in contrast to Oriol and Mena, for instance, or Baker proposal, where only the high skilled worker were willing to take the mechanism, and at the same time limit or control migration flow, which is a demand in advanced economy. So this scheme rely on existing legal framework. It's not totally out of the blue. There are large temporary foreign worker program right now that are used in Cyprus, Israel, Canada, Gulf country, and Southeast Asia. In particular, in Gulf country in Southeast Asia, they are often criticized for violation of human rights or worker rights. So there are a lot of abuse attached to this contract. And so we try to see whether they can be overcome and why they are so abusive in certain type of circumstances. The way we model the decision of migrants is that we internalize the risks they face, which is very often, strangely enough, totally overlooked by researchers. They tend to focus on risk-neutral migrants, but when you see the risk of failure, which is on some route 80%, which is huge, risk of failure, neglecting attitude towards risk is very unrealistic, we believe. So we believe that the fact that some migrants took their chance, although the risks are very, very high that they fail, reflect distorted risk perception. And that's why we, when we calibrate the price of visa, we look, we take into account this distorted risk perception with a prospect theory from Tersky and Kahneman. But all the theoretical results we get are valid also with expected utility theory. So this is not crucial for the theory, but we believe it is important to explain empirical evidence to internalize this distorted risk perception. So the risk of illegal migration is key, we believe, to design workable temporary visa. So the outline is we discuss the smuggling market, then the temporary legal visa scheme, and some results on policy and numerical application. So the smuggling market. So we focus on markets that are not competitive. They are entry cost. Why they are entry cost? Because they are barrier to immigration. We invest a lot in repression, border control, at sea, but also in airport, etc. So it's not easy to smuggle migrants. And so we have typically a few criminal network that provide services. And the way we model it, it's a la Cournot, it's competition in quantity. So there are N smugglers, and the price they apply is solution to the equation you have on the slide. So this price, and this price, as you can see, vary between when N goes to infinity competitive price, so marginal cost, and when N is one, you have the monopoly price. So it's very convenient because it's flexible. If you take a Bertrand competition with entry cost, you will have a monopoly always, so you will always have this price, and we don't believe it's very realistic. You can have other form of imperfect competition. As long as the price and the quantity decrease with N, the price decrease with N and the quantity increase with N, the results I am going to present are valid. So we took this specification. So what is the risk and the model? So we assume workers are heterogeneous. They have skill theta that follow density and CDF F theta over support from zero to infinity. And they behave rationally. So this is under standard expected utility theory or with behavioral more realistic trait. This is according to cumulative prospect theory by Tversky and Kahneman, this model was, so you find the reference in the 92 paper, and that's lands the Nobel Prize to Kahneman. Tversky was dead, so he couldn't get it. So one migrant faces the following lottery with probability Q, he or she will fail migration. So she or he try, but she cannot reach the destination country. So she is back at home We assume that at home there is some returns to skill. So this function is simply increasing with theta, and omega h is the home wage minus the visa price, sorry, the smuggler fee they have to pay, even if the migration fails. If they succeed, which occur with 1 minus q probability, in this case they get the wage omega f. This is minimum income in the developed country or the destination country, sorry. And there is a discount d because they are in the illegal sector, in the informal sector, since they are not documented worker. And of course, again, they have to pay the price pi. They have to compare this benefit to not doing anything, so staying at home. So if they stay at home, they have this wage, which is the per unit wage multiplied by the skills, or the return of the skill more specifically. And so in the particular case where migration is failed, they are left with simply a loss, which is a loss of the money they invested in their migration, and that was not profitable in the end. So when we look at the equilibrium of this market, so this is with prospect theory. So we have weighted function of the risk because the Kahneman and Tversky show that the perception of risk is distorted. And then this is an utility function, which is typically a shape. So they have some people seems to exhibit some test for risk and when they are in the negative payoff, and on the contrary, aversion to risk when they are in the positive payoff. So this gives us this function. With expected utility theory, this is very, very similar, but you don't have weight. You have the objective probability and the Cara function, for instance, U. And so we are looking for the marginal migrant, so the theta I that is indifferent between moving. So going into the illegal sector or trying to go into the illegal sector in the advanced economy or staying at home. And once you have this illegal migrant, the demand is simply the integral between zero and theta I of all the people that will move, that will try to reach the advanced economy with smuggler. And this threshold depend, of course, on the returns to of illegal migration compared to the home income. One important assumption, there is no return to skill abroad. Why? Because you are in the illegal sector in the advanced economy. We are looking at low skill worker. And so typically what you are going to do, this is what studies show, you are going to work in work construction, in restaurant or home services, and all this activity or agriculture have very low returns to skills. It doesn't matter if you know how to read or count, or if you are an engineer, you will be paid minimum wage with a discount because you are in the informal economy. So this implies that you have a negative selection because you have return to skill at home, but you don't have it in the informal sector of low skill employment. And so if you're very skilled, you don't want to go through this smuggler route to clean plate in a restaurant, and you prefer use your skill at home with a bigger returns, or use other channel to migrate. So what are the temporary visa schemes that can fight back this illegal smuggling business? Well, the government can sell temporary visa. When I say sell, it can be a subsidy, actually. So you can pay people to come temporarily in your country to do stuff, which happened, of course, and during the COVID crisis, for instance. In France, we some Moroccan worker came to Corsica to pick oranges and clementine. And well, they were subsidized in the sense that the ticket were paid, etc. I mean, it was really organized, and it, of course, it's much better than letting people drown into the Mediterranean. So you have a visa price PL, can be negative, and a duration tau, so number of years, you are allowed to stay in exchange for this visa price. The government is a stakeholder leader. It's mean it work, it move first, and then the smuggler reacts, and they have to adjust to the government. This is not the other way around. And so they will fix their own price based on this legal fees plus temporary duration. So the goal in this paper, we focus on a mechanism, PLTO, that is such that it price out smugglers. So smugglers cannot survive, namely the price they can apply is below their marginal cost. So if it's below their marginal cost, clearly they are going to exit the market because not only they don't cover the fixed cost, but they are losing money each time one migrant is smuggled. So we need to take into account some different type of constraints. The first constraint is that some migrants at the price PL want to move legally, temporarily in the advanced or in the host country. So typically, it would take the form of this inequation here. There is no risk now because it's legal. So the revenue you make legally while moving temporarily, which is TO time on the wage in the destination country. So now there is no day anymore because it's legal work, and so you get the full minimum wage. Plus one minus TO, you return at home. You are only allowed to stay for TO period. So the rest of the time, you will work at home. And here you have some return on your skill, minus the price of the visa, the legal visa, must be bigger than what you get when you stay at home all the time. This gives you a marginal migrant. We can generalize this model without really difficulty. And so all the results I will present after that fly. In particular, we can have some returns to skill in the legal sector in the form of delta F theta, as long as these returns are lower than in the home country, which is a very sensible assumption because typically in destination country, people average level of education is higher. And so skills returns will be everything else equal lower. And also we have a more technical assumption that is the marginal returns in terms of wage of skills is lower for the domestic market than for the for the foreign market than for the domestic market. So this ensures again a negative selection of workers. So now the first constraint was participation constraint. The second constraint is incentive constraint, because now you have the choice between the legal alternative. So I pay PL and I go for a period TO in the legal sector of the destination country, or I pay PI, take the risk with a risk of deportation Q, and a discount on my income, which is D, to work for all my working life in the illegal sector. What we want to understand is what will make this theta LI go to zero so that the illegal sector vanish. One issue with temporary visa scheme, which is a very important issue, as I will try to convince you, is to incentivize workers, so we call that self-enforceability, to return home after their visa expire, and this is not easy. Okay, why? This is not easy because you can come in the country with a legal visa for a period TO, and at the expiration of TO, you stay illegally this time in the home country, and that's occur a lot. And this overstaying is a real problem with this temporary visa. A lot of also undocumented workers were tourists initially or students, and then they overstay their visa. So how can we fight against this problem of overstaying? Well, one solution, which is employed by ASEAN migration, is to have a share of the income earned abroad that is retained and that will be handled back upon a timely return of the immigrant in his or her home country. And also, you can do something else, which is increase the risk of deportation of undocumented migrant at home, which is different from Q, which is the risk of failing the migration. Here, you have you are already in the home in the host country, and police or work can arrest you because you're undocumented and deport you. So what we can show, it is always possible as long as the delta, the risk of deportation is high enough, and in fact can be very high, close to one sometimes, to have a self-enforceable short-term visa. What we can show is the complementarity of the instrument, in the sense that this minimum deportation threshold is decreasing with S, the retention rate. So the more, the larger the retention rate, of course, the bigger the incentive of the migrant to go back at the end of the at the end of the tow period, because otherwise he or she loses the fraction of her income that were retained. It decreases with tow. Of course, the longer the duration of the temporary visa, the stronger the incentive to go back at the end because you made more money. And it's decreased with D, so the lower the returns in the informal economy, the easier it is to enforce the temporary nature of the visa. The smugglers are going to respond to this policy by setting a price PI to try to catch the residual demand. Their illegal demand is between zero and theta LI. And so the government is going to set a price PL of visa, which is such that it is below the eviction price PL lower bar. What is this mysterious eviction price? It is such that theta LI equals zero for PI equals C. And so it's very easy to find it. You have to simply put here a value of reaction function for PI equal to C. So you really push the legal sector outside by pricing the legal visa low enough. It's a very intuitive result. So what we can show that the eviction price, so this minimum price, so that the smuggler cannot operate anymore, which depends on the duration of the visa, is implicitly defined by the following equation. So this equation, you have replaced the reaction function of the smuggler by C. So you want PI to be equal to C, so you put it there, and you find, of course, in this case, implicitly, the minimum price you should apply to get this reaction. And this minimum price increases with tau, the duration. Again, with C, the marginal cost of the smuggler, and Q, the risk of failed migration. And it decreases with D, the discount you get in the illegal sector of the economy. So there are complementarity of instruments again, and in an intuitive way as before. So sponsoring migrants can occur. So the minimum price can be negative. And this might be required to attract temporary workers when the risk of illegal migration is very low, and when Q is very low, and when the return to illegal work are very high, like for instance in Japan. So the minimum duration of temporary visa required to set a positive eviction price to again decrease with the instrument Q and C, and increase with D, which is a always the same intuition, so I'm not going to repeat it. So one question we might have in mind is that the government might want to maintain at least the same skill diversity of foreign workers following the introduction of the temporary worker scheme when it's solid at the eviction price. And so to increase skill diversity, you need to set the visa duration below a threshold theta tilde, which is equal to this simple equation. So why below? Because you remember there is a positive returns to skills or higher return to skill in home countries and in host country. And so if the duration of the visa is very long, you are going to screen out skilled workers that prefer to not lost their human capital in the low occupation, low pay job in the host country. So shorter visa means you can attract students, you can attract worker with some skills because this allows them to save. And for instance, when they go back home, they can start a firm or a business. And this you will not have if the visa is very long because they erode their human capital in low skill occupation in host country. So there is a trade-off again of overstaying, and that's an issue. So it is very expensive to enforce internal and external control, typically. And so to dismantle a smuggler through a cost-effective sales of temporary visa of duration two, and while meeting, the labor market needs for T permanent equivalent worker, a government should invest the amount E1, E2, and E3 in internal and external control, solution to the following equation. So this give you this equation, equation two, give you the volume of worker you will need to get the equivalent of T permanent equivalent worker. And this equation there simply state that the marginal investment in increasing the marginal cost of smuggler should be equal to the marginal returns of increasing the cost for illegal for employing illegal workers, so the cost on a firm that employ illegal worker, and this should be equal to the marginal impact on border enforcement, external border enforcement, since Q is the probability of failing migration. So this is the standard result of the marginal returns on investment. And theta L should be solution to this equation as before, which is that's a benefit of moving is equal to for the marginal worker to the benefit of staying at home. And so these skills typically will decrease with two. So we then have some numerical application. So for the wage, minimum wage, we consider two routes of migration. So we consider Senegal to Spain and the Republic Democratic of Congo to South Africa. Both routes are, of course, realistic, and they are migration of temporary, low skill migrant between these two routes. And so the problem for South Africa, Republic Democratic of Congo, and Senegal, we do not have a minimum wage because in the home country, because the official minimum wage is simply in the legal, in the formal sector, and in Senegal, 90% of the population work in the informal economy. So this tells us nothing. So what we do, we estimate with a log normal distribution income, and we calibrate it using a Gini coefficient and GDP per capita. So just to have a quick look at what it gives us, it's not very difficult. If you have the Gini coefficient for a country, then you can compute the variance based on this calibration exercise, and the expected value of R is simply the expected of mu plus sigma 2 divided by 2. So you can extract the density function you need for theta based on that. So for instance, in Senegal, the Gini coefficient is 39%. The GDP per capita per annum is 2,500 roughly. In Spain, Gini is 31%, and we are at 32,000, so 10 times more. when you calibrate on this log income in Senegal and Spain, this give you in we have all the data, the variable of income in PPP per annum. It is give you this distribution, and so like that we can have the lifetime income at home is simply income per annum time 40 period, 40 annum, 40 years, and then we can retrieve from that the minimum income. So this is how we calibrate for the country where we don't have the relevant information. And then we use the Tversky and Kahneman functional form. The advantage of using them and using their calibration, they give us value for alpha, for this weighting function, etc., is that we can have a closed form expression for the eviction price. So the eviction price under Tversky and Kahneman typically will have this shape. If you are interested, all the computations are in the paper. You have to trust me in this short presentation. And then we can compute the minimum retention share, S lower bar, using an iterative solver on the self-enforceability constraint that we saw earlier on, apply to the minimum skill zero. Indeed, the first worker to come is the worker with skills normalized to zero. And so if this worker is willing to come back, every other type of worker will also be willing to come back. So this ensures this constraint that all type of worker will come back at the end of the visa of duration two. So we can look at the variation in share of migrant that can be retrieved from variation in income. And so this simply, with our assumption, can be calibrated using the cumulative density function of the normal distribution. And so this is how we can retrieve this value. Okay, so these are the benchmark value. So for the Democratic Republic of Congo, the value of monthly income is in PPP 36. Since the route we look at is from DRC to South Africa, where the monthly income is 155 PPP, it means that it's 5 times larger, while from Senegal to Spain, it's 10 times larger. Now it's 88 compared to 857 PPP. For the value D, we take 0.8. There are some studies showing that the discount in the formal sector for undocumented worker is 20%. The marginal cost, of course, it's very difficult to have information on that, but the study we have suggests roughly 1,150 for Senegal to Spain, and from DRC to South Africa, it's 830. And smuggling price this time, this is not the same as marginal cost, is 100 and 700 PPP, while for DRC to South Africa, it's 1,220, where it's roughly 30% of markup compared to the marginal cost. So this is a numerical application. I think it's quite telling. So this heat map, what they tell you, so let's focus on Senegal to Spain. So here on the axis, you have the risk of failing migration. This risk is very high. For the benchmark case, we take 80%. But even if you take 65%, so the result, of course, evolve intuitively, but they remain the same. And on the on the vertical axis, you have the visa duration in years. So 2, 4 years, 6 years, 8 years. The dashed line here is the price, the eviction price that is zero. So at this price, it means your visa is free. In the green part of the heat map, the visa is positive. You can apply the positive visa. So for instance, here, the visa price is 3,733 PPP. While in the red part of the heat map, the visa is negative. If you want to kill a smuggler, you have to pay a migrant to come to your country. So what can we learn from the comparison of these two routes? We see that from Senegal to Spain, the simulation of the eviction price is extremely sensitive to the assumption. A small variation in the calibration value mean a big jump in terms of the result. So, for instance, if you move around this value, you move from a very positive price to a very negative price. What does it mean? And why it is like that? It's like that because the price differential between Senegal to Spain in terms of income is 10 times. So it's a huge pull factor. And that's implied in our words that the simulation are sensitive to the assumption in this case. And that's also hint to the fact that it would be very hard in the case from a very low income country to the high income country to implement temporary visa efficiently. It's a challenge. It's much simpler when the differential in income is smaller, as we can see on the DRC to South Africa route, where the values are much more stable and are less sensitive to assumption on risk of failure or visa duration. Another way to see the problem of this temporary visa is the self-enforcement constraint. So you remember there are several constraints you need to meet for the program to be successful. One very important one, and we know it is violated very often, is the fact that the migrant at the end of their the temporary visa go back home. And what this graph shows you is the following. In the white area, it is impossible to find a retention rate, S, such that the migrant will come back after at the expiration of his or her visa. So if the discount of the revenue is only 20%, so if when you go in the informal economy of the host country, you make 80% of the legal wage, then unless the probability of deportation is close to 80% and the visa duration is 8 years, unless that all these conditions are met, you will never go back at the end of your visa. Note that this dashed line here corresponds to a retention rate of 60%. 60% is totally unrealistic. When we look at remittance rate, it's maximum 50%. And in some countries like France, it's only 12%. So you cannot retain 60%. Here, retention rate is 100%. This type of graph show you the difficulty to have a self-enforcing mechanism. A very promising, we believe, tool is the variation of D. So D mean also because the probability of deportation on SUAR in the host country are low. And so statistics on that that we have suggest that they are closer to 30%. This is an estimate from the European Commission, for instance. So typically, you will be here. So if you are here, there is no, if D is 0.8, there is no way you can have a temporary visa that is self-enforceable between Spain and Senegal and Spain. On the other hand, if you are able to put some pressure on the employer of the illegal, of the undocumented migrant, in this particular case, it's much simpler to enforce the visa. the temporary nature of the visa. So this is a key instrument, we believe, and an instrument that puts the pressure not on the migrant, but on the firm that exploits them. So let's try to increase that. And if you look at statistics, in France, I think in 2017, there were less than 300 infractions for employing undocumented workers in France that were all or less than, I don't remember the exact figure, but it's very, very low when you look at statistics. And so this is something that we could, of course, improve in advanced economy. And intuitively, when the gap, the wage gap is smaller, it's a little bit easier to enforce the temporary nature of the visa. So to conclude, and I will be very happy to discuss with you on the paper. We have derived an optimal policy mix to focus on the sale of temporary visa should be combined with enforcement of internal and border control. The advantage of this type of mechanism is that there is no necessarily a policy trade-off between legalization and the number of migrants that will come. What is a big problem is self-enforceability. This is a very strong constraint, especially for south-north migration, far less for south-south migration. The reason why these programs are working so well in Gulf country or in Southeast Asia, because there they do not mind deporting very harshly undocumented migrants. So Delta is quite large in this country because they really don't care about human rights or worker rights, or not so much. Also, they have very high retention rates. So for instance, temporary workers have to give a deposit of $10,000 on some route to be able to work for a couple of years in Southeast or in Gulf countries. So of course, if you have a deposit of $10,000, you want to get it back. And because of that, you go back at the expiration of your visa. So combination of a very high retention rate and very harsh deportation measure make this contract self-enforceable. I'm not sure we can really, or even want to have such harsh measure against worker from South country. So one option we believe is to put more pressure on employer. And I will stop there. So we believe this work could help to facilitate orderly, safe, regular, and responsibility migration. So just a perk, this is an ad on Facebook to buy me a visa if you have fake passport, if you want. Here's the traduction. Okay, I stop here.
Thank you very much for this great presentation and all this this information. It was very great listening to it. Let's jumpstart right into the discussion and open the floor for any questions, any comments. You could raise your hand using the reaction button, the emoji button. I already see a hand. I see Ana Maria. You can go ahead and unmute yourself. Great. I don't hear you, or at least I don't. I'm not sure if
me,
anyone.
Me neither. Me neither. Okay.
Sorry, Anna, we don't hear you.
No, still not
hearing. No.
Ah, yes, go ahead.
Yes, okay, great. Oh, well, thank you very much for this presentation and for this proposal. I think it's very, very interesting. I just have two questions. I see that you take into account, when you design the model, you took into account the behavior of the smugglers, of the host country, and also of the migrant. And I was thinking that probably something that you could also address, or an actor that you may be missing and that probably plays an important role, is also the industries, you know, those that are interested in hiring illegal migrants, because they can actually pay them less, so it's the business becomes more profitable. So I was wondering how your proposal is also goes also in benefit of the industries of the businesses that are interested in hiring legal migrants. And I have also another question that I was thinking that probably could be a limit of your proposal, because you say, well, in this way, we are just going to completely eliminate smugglers. And I was thinking probably it's too optimistic. Maybe we are just going to reduce it, but not completely eliminate them, because I was thinking that when you have these temporary visa programs, not everyone is eligible. Not everyone, gets into the program. Sometimes there are even quotas, and I was wondering whether this could actually generate a new business for smugglers in a way of helping them to get into the program, or just taking over those that do not qualify for the program. So in a way, I think it's an interesting proposal. I was just wondering whether the proposal underestimating that the role that the smugglers could still play, even though the proposal goes in place.
Thank you very much, Anna Maria. So I think you make a very valid point about the business industry that could lobby, for instance, because it's clear that those in advanced economies that employ undocumented workers and pay them less than the minimum income, they are in fact infringing even competition law, because it's not fair compared to firms that are paying legal workers and that have to pay the full minimum wage plus social security contribution. So it's totally true that the interest of firms that want to have documented workers or that refrain from hiring undocumented one, this particular benefit is not included in the paper, and it's partial equilibrium. So that's true. But so we have this black box, which is D, the discount on the wage that we use. What we believe, for instance, me, I am from France, and what happened in France, the status quo is very bad, I think. Why? Because voters are really against immigration in an irrational way, I think, from an economic perspective, at least. Yet firms need workers. So the equilibrium right now is to say we are against immigration, so we don't open immigration to unqualified workers. There are some channels for qualified one, but not for unqualified worker. And it's the same in the UK, for instance, and all over Europe. And since we still need this worker, since they are missing worker, well, we are a bit very hypocrite and we let undocumented worker fill the gap. So that's true that some sector like construction, for instance, they have no choice really, I think right now in the status quo than to use some, to employ some undocumented worker. But some of them could be very happy, I suspect, having a documented one. So if we move forward, we need to make sure that we open the enough position, we sell enough visa, or we subsidize enough visa, so enough worker will come. And that's a big challenge, I think, on the political economy side, where many voters are irrational, and really irrational. Right now, we see the Brexit. We see people, they don't have oil, they are not going to get the Christmas gift, and yet they're still for Brexit. So there is some irrationality in voter. So that's the first point. For the volume, I tend to think that you are right, we are not going to get rid of totally of smuggling. Why? Because some sector are by nature in the informal economy or in the illegal economy, even like prostitution, for instance, and drug dealing. So there will always be smuggling of, for instance, of sex slave. It's very hard. But here, They are increasing to two scales. So if you are smuggling sex slave, you can also smuggling some worker. But I think it is possible to fight against smuggler of worker. We need this worker. We really do need them. We need people in construction. And I think one good example is Canada, for instance. Canada, the one of the most dynamic visa is one of temporary nature. There are some abuse, of course, when the migrant, for instance, is living with the employer, like in agriculture. So you can, in this particular case, there can be some abuse. But there are also temporary workers in construction, in mining, etc. And this Canada is not a Gulf country. I mean, they respect worker rights. And so it seems to me that it's possible to move from the bad equilibrium we have in France or in the UK to a much more virtuous one where 300,000 people get a temporary visa like in Canada to do stuff we need them to do and for a couple of years and then they go back. One way also to incentivize people to go with the temporary visa rather than smuggler is to make sure they get bonus, they get credits, for instance, a score if you want, if they are complying with the visa specification. So if at the end of the visa they go back home, the next time they apply, it will be much more easy for them to get a visa. And this is what Canada is doing also. So there are a lot of ways to think out of the box and try to improve the situation. I agree, it will not totally solve the problem, but it could really improve the situation for many workers, and many migrants. And also, I think the advantage, which is not captured in this paper, but which is very real and very important, is that you can communicate on the real opportunity, economic opportunity that you have at destination. Because I know that some migrants, they really believe that the opportunities are huge. And when they arrive, at least in France, they can be living in the street and be in very harsh condition. And it's a failed migration. You can really inform migrants, say, don't come. There is no work if there is no work. And come, there are works. And so it's easier to communicate when everything is legal than when smugglers are just selling dreams that are not real. They can really lie. Well, they don't care, to be honest. They don't care about human life, and they don't care about truth neither. I hope it answers.
Yes, thank you very much.
Yeah, just reading honestly the post that you have. I read it very quickly in Arabic as well, but it is very common to see, like, for example, I'm from Egypt, and it was very common when I was working for the UNHCR to have to have people come to the office and give us passports that belong to other people, and they pay a fortune in it. Like, they spend all their money that they had left from home, everything, just for a passport that they're brainwashed into getting it for resettlement to get outside of the country, etc. But yeah, the post is shocking.
Yeah, it is shocking.
A lot of money.
But it's true. I mean, well, this is for this type of thing is for the comfortable, the safe route. The other one, they pay less, but the risk are.
Yeah. I see a question from Wallasi, who was interning very recently with our institute. He told me his mic is not working. So it's in the chat box. I can read it out. So jumping in this discussion of fairness and competition, usually the models encompass an Africa-Europe migration, and it is pretty challenging to adapt to the costs of migrating from South America or Asia, for instance. Do you believe that this model works for those regions too? And how can we address currency variation in this model?
So the model I present, I think, is quite general, but maybe I misunderstood the question. What matters then is the wage differential, the gap, and also how easy it is to, so if you have a border, a common border, it's much more easy to cross than if you have an ocean or the continent to cross. The what I don't know what you are specialist, and all of you of immigration, but what strike me when I worked on this topic was the lack of study that is not centered on rich country. I mean, you have very few South-South study of illegal migration and the cost and benefit, etc. So that's why we included here South-South route. And we show that in this particular case, it's more, it's easier to put in place a legal system because when the gap between destination and host country is smaller, it's easier to enforce everything. But I think what we are presenting here is apply in any context. What will vary is delta, the value of deportation. I think in some country, this delta is very large. And so you can, and the retention rate, as I was mentioning, in some destination is $10,000 that you have to pay upfront before being able to move. Of course, this money is give you back when you go back, but you have to go back. So, and they don't care about putting people in jail or their rights. I mean, they are very harsh on the immigrant and there are many abuse, and this is why it is criticized. But if in the model, this can be translated into a very, very low or very high delta, very high S, etc. So I think the model is general. I agree if I get your point right that there are not enough research about this type of migration from south to south. I mean, I think we need more work on that. But I don't know if it was exactly the concern.
I know we're out of time, but I just want to give a last minute if anyone would like to ask any questions. Any more questions in the house? Okay, I don't see any hands raised, so I'll take that as a no. So thank you all for attending today's seminar. Again, thank you very much, Professor Auriol, for this great presentation. It's always very interesting to hear about irregular migration and the studies on that. I would also like to let you all know that we already have scheduled a seminar, a migration seminar next month in November. So it's on the 17th of November, and it's going to be on immigration and welfare state development in the long run by Dr. Alexander Afonso.
So thanks. If you have any further comment or references or whatever, please do not hesitate to drop me a line on my email. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Bye-bye. Thank you all for coming and have a great rest of the day.
Bye-bye.